coming in order. Start with roll calls.
Okay, Mayor Minnie.
Here.
Brenneman.
Here.
Keel.
Here.
Monahan.
Here.
Horn.
Here.
Nelson.
Here.
And Jones.
Here.
All right, do we have any additions to the agenda, or do we have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Motion second, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hear none? Okay. All right, next we'll look for motions to approve the minutes of the meeting on 8:15, and then a separate motion to approve the minutes on 8:28.
A motion to approve regular meeting minutes for 8:15, 2017.
Second.
Okay, discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Make another motion to approve special budget meeting minutes for 8:28, 2017.
Second that.
Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. No bills submitted for payment. We can move on. First item up is a special event application for the West Central Homecoming Parade. And it looks like we don't have somebody here representing that, but in the packet it looked pretty straightforward.
Yeah, Craig Moyens submitted this on behalf of West Central. They have their homecoming activities coming up on September 22nd, that Friday. The parade will be roughly from 1:30 to 3 o'clock, so they'll be, you know, using city streets for that. So they ask that we approve the parade for homecoming, and then they ask that we waive the application fee.
Make a motion to approve request and waive the fee.
Second.
Okay, we have a second by Nelson.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, any discussion? All right, Monahan?
Yeah.
Jones?
Yes.
Brenneman?
Yes.
Keel?
Yes.
Horn?
Yes.
And Nelson?
Yes.
Okay. Now we'll move to the next piece up, which is the first reading of ordinance 647, which is the 2018 appropriation ordinance.
Okay, and 647 is our actual budget ordinance for next year, 2018. So the numbers we had in our worksheets during our work session, our budget session, have just been transferred into this ordinance. And like I said, it has to be an ordinance, so we'll have first reading and second reading before we can send it on to the county. I did include in your packet our actual, I just kind of condensed them down, our revenue and expense sheets, and highlighted the amounts that changed at our budget meeting, you know, things we added to either the revenue side or the expense side. Okay, any questions?
And this is a first reading of an ordinance. Does this also follow the same guidelines of first and second reading that we've had before, where we don't vote on this, but we have our first reading and we take it to our next meeting and have our second reading and then vote?
I think as we just learned, you don't have to vote on. We always have in the past, and I think we still can. It just, it's the second vote that counts, you know, that, right?
That's right. So, I mean, preferred guidance on that, Mr. Nelson? Is that...
You have to have a first and second reading. I suppose if you voted no, one could argue that it doesn't move forward to a second reading. It would be an opportunity to kill dogs that aren't going to, you know, be worth the time to have that second reading. I would tell you that if there's a substantial change at the second reading, and I don't know what substantial change means, then of course you're required to wait the 5 days before you actually have a third reading.
Right.
So I assume it's going to move forward. I like the procedure if it gets through the first reading and we move on to the second reading, just to me it's clear. So I prefer you vote it if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The only reason I bring that up is we had that with that piece of property, and it didn't pass the first reading, but it, the way the law read was that we had to have the second reading.
Did you have to have two readings, yeah?
And so technically, you don't have to. An interesting thing would be, let's just assume that it failed tonight. I would still tell you that it moved forward because it didn't have the second reading. But it would give the proponents of it the opportunity to work to the commission.
Okay.
I don't know what to tell you, Jim.
Okay.
I don't know, Mayor, I'm sorry, I shouldn't be so informal, Mayor.
Let me throw a monkey in the wrench. If you, after we, you know, went through the budget and suddenly something, epiphany hit you 2 days later, and you really wanted to have something added to that budget for 2018, could you, in essence, amend the written budget 647 and request an addition, or are we set in stone right now where we're at?
I think you can amend it at your second reading.
Okay, amend it, but I would call that a substantial change if we are adding something into the budget. So that would mean, and we have to get this to the county.
I know that.
So that would mean we probably would have to have a special meeting 5 days later.
And that's why I was hypothetically speaking.
Third reading, yeah.
I did have something that popped into my head, but it wasn't that important to the point where it's worth rocking the horse.
So let's take it through hypothetically and under your budget. Under General Fund 1, you wanted to add $900 for the desk writers. Mm-hmm. Not 800, 900. The question would be, is that not a substantial change? I would tell you I don't think it is.
No.
But if you were going to do a mill levy change in some portion of your ordinance from 1% to 1.1%, my question would be, how much dough does it raise? How much money is it? And, you know, if it raised $5, let's not have a second reading. If it raised $5,000, maybe we should, just to be safe,
right,
read it the second time.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Or the third time, actually.
Yeah, I'm just thinking more down the line is all I was thinking as far as that kind of stuff. Okay, thank you.
With that, I'll make a motion to pass first reading of Ordinance 647.
Second.
Okay. Motion and second. Further discussion? I hear none. Nelson?
Yes.
Horn?
Yep.
Field?
Yes.
Brennan?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
And Monahan?
Yeah.
Right. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, we've got reports. And first one up is the Sheriff's Deputy Report, Chancey Porter.
Had a pretty slow summer as far as everything, which is good. So we're back into the speed enforcement in the school zones. I don't know what they're doing on Highway 38. I just brought to my attention that now that they're taking railroads, so I'll incorporate that as far as the morning and afternoon speeds. Colton Road, since that's been done, is kind of a racetrack out there, so I've been sitting out there quite a bit. And then Mickelson Road and Spider Avenue, the stop signs, the three-way stop signs, have been brought to my attention, so I've been sitting there a little bit. Special attention to commercial vehicles on the city streets. Not sure if a letter got sent out or not, but I haven't seen.
Yep.
So I haven't dealt with that since the letters went out. And then another issue with the dogs in the park. And I sat there tonight for a while, and I didn't have any issues. But the individual that we did have complaints on saw me sitting there with his dog, so he didn't come over. So, but other than that, that's all I got. So.
I know, and you would have had it on here if it was still an issue there in a while. There was just minor break-ins and vehicle break-ins and garages and things like that. I didn't see that around the county at all, or is it?
Mm-hmm. No, this summer was actually super slow for the county itself, so was good. And then even just the city of Hartford, just a couple vandalisms in the park. So, other than that, it was a good summer for us.
Vandalism part, how have you done this year compared to years past? It seemed I haven't heard from a whole 2 months.
It's been better. I think it's been now.
What do you attribute that to?
Kids.
mean, because it's been here ever since I've sat in this chair, is vandalism in the park.
You know, every
different
year.
Kids.
Different kids.
Wow.
Good yeah. parenting.
Good parenting.
Okay. Fair enough. Chancey Ford. I mean,
yeah.
Chancey.
Yeah.
I don't know. One was right away at the beginning of the soap dispensers, and then just the most recent one that just happened with the pad or the tables. So,
okay.
I don't know, I think it was
pretty good,
so.
Press on.
Eccleston's been, they've been really coming by our place on Eccleston bad.
Yeah.
Really bad.
And I have a feeling of the 38 between Railroad and Eccleston, it's going to pick up, so.
Yeah.
I know the school zone is 15, but if people are going to cut across, I'm just, I think in the mornings, I'm going to sit over there a few mornings in a row, just kind of make a presence over there. I sit on Nichols, or Railroad in the afternoons, but I'll definitely switch it over to the mornings and late afternoons. So.
We hear them bottom out, we know they're probably going a little bit over.
Yeah, for sure. So, and even when I even had gravel up there, it turns my camera on because it's so rough, so people are going to hit that at a higher speed, it's going to turn into an accident, so.
Yeah.
You take that once, you probably don't take it again, so you think it's the same person 1,000 times, or 10
well,
times?
I don't know. We've had, because when the weather cooled off and we've had the windows open, there's been a couple times at midnight, 1 o'clock, man, I'm telling you, I don't know how fast
it's yeah, and I have passed it on to the nighttime deputies to watch, or to sit on that road, specifically that road, so.
And both ways, we heard one going. And I can't imagine they're going, like Travis said, they're going that fast on that gravel as rough as that is. I can't imagine they're keeping her on the road.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's terrible down there.
It is really bad.
So, anyway.
His request in that regard, and I believe we're making progress with Stumpy's also.
Yes.
So, I guess after we're right with that, still waiting on the agreements to get approved before we take the project to bid. In our office, we're working on revising the construction documents and just new utility projects, so it'll be sewer and water. And then, once we have the agreements approved, we can take it to bid, I guess. Any questions on that project?
Do you think anything's going to happen this fall?
I hope so. I mean, it comes down to these agreements, getting them approved.
I'm hoping at the next council meeting, if not sooner, one of the agreements nailed down. I've indicated that to ask them when we met, and he's indicated that to Rob and I for Stumpy's, and I'm hoping we'll be in this week, but we'll see. I said no later than the second meeting.
As bad as the bike path.
Me and Mitch have talked, if we can get, you know, approval to go ahead and bid, it's like, maybe we can still do it, so.
Yeah, and assuming we get that approval, we'll have, to me, we have the next meeting, we have a recommendation to take it to bid. We'll have that waiting for you guys, and then we'll have the plans ready to take those to bid, too, so.
So what if one of these parties that are involved just say, no, I don't like agreements, if you don't do it my way, tough. Then what?
So, you know, if Assam says that, we could, and we got Stumpy on board, we could still build the project to the Jardines development, you could consider that. You know, if Stumpy's don't get on board, we need, really what we need from him is the corner property to make that radius through there. So if you don't get that from him, then we could still take it to Jardines and then there. So I think if either one of them backed out, we could still do the project for there at least.
Have Jardines and Jacobsmas, so
yeah.
We could at least get it there with what we've got already, because we've got those agreements signed already, so.
Yeah. Well, I think we kind of indicated to Sam at the last meeting, at the special budget meeting, that that is a possibility.
Right.
If he keeps backing, I'm telling you, that motion could be quicker than what?
I guess that's why I'm asking, because if we don't have my next meeting, I hopefully come up with a plan B as a council.
Yeah.
All you.
Should love it.
Okay, Vandermark Avenue, we have our plans complete, we sent them to Teresa, Craig and her are gonna review them quick, and we're planning on having them at the next meeting to present to you folks. We'll have them at the next meeting to present to you. Mike Franken Trail Project, we have a pre-construction meeting scheduled for tomorrow, so we'll be attending that. Sure Craig, you'll be attending as well, possibly? While I'll be there, our people will be there, and, sounds like they're gonna wanna start working possibly even towards the end of this week on that project, so I'd say next week, for sure, they'll probably be turning some dirt. On the Force Count side, been working with the Schwartzley property still, had a western, a plan review in the Western Meadows, South Main, and we're doing some inspections out there on the South Main addition. They need to get their top lift asphalt on that addition, so we're working with the developer there to get that accomplished. Been hoping with the 2018 budget and project areas. Any questions?
I'm here, no? Thank you, Mitch.
Yep.
Okay, alright, Craig with Public Works update.
For streets, the slurry seal project went well, they actually did, we did some few patches on some areas on 6th, 7th, and also on Genie Circle that were always holding water. Just kind of a patch over them, they, you know, just did those for nothing, didn't charge us for them. Like much of the South Main addition, we've been going around checking valves, manholes, make sure that's all ready to go, and everything's good there. We'll make sure that it gets good and clean, so before they get around to putting that second lift on. Traffic counters, we did get the traffic counters up on, put them on Vandermark, about halfway down on the gravel part there, and then also up right by Travis's place here, just to see what traffic's coming made it out of town, which one's actually coming down Park T, and then along with that, we can check speed count, or counts, speed, and direction of vehicle travel, and vehicle identification, whether it's trucks or small vehicles, whatever it is. So we just pulled them today. We'll get a download and get a report back. When I get a report back, I'll just have it. So you guys can see what actually is going on with the traffic and that, kind of get an idea, at least for this first time, and get an idea of what the traffic things can do.
That's something you can just email out to us?
I'm sure that can be, if I can.
Somebody? I'm sure the recording process is put off in this hand, and we can just.
Yeah, we can do that.
Print it and scan it. Give it to Teresa.
I can scan, I don't want to do that. So we'll figure it out and get that part going. Sidewalk line Preston Trail there, that has been completed. We've got some stuff coming up that later. Mickelson Road, it's not on here, but I'll make sure we get that dressed up so we don't have the cars bottoming when they go flying through there. And DOT update, I guess I can throw that in my report. They are, what they're doing up there is they're gonna widen the shoulders, make it basically a safer highway for speed and that stuff. They're putting about a 4 foot gravel shoulder on, then they're gonna oil it. They will be running a pilot car through there to get the traffic back and forth. And it's not going to be completed until about the middle of October, so it's going to be slow traffic up there for quite a while. Along with that, I sent the stuff out, both this actually sent something to Travis and Teresa did, and they're still working on those lights up on Highway 38. We're still trying to get some stuff figured out on them, so he's still waiting to get back to the contract up there. Water and sewer, we checked the pH up there. Actually, the pH did come down within limits, so we can check it again tomorrow. If it's down again tomorrow, then we'll take a TSS BOD in the morning and see if that's good. And if it is, we'll be discharging. So, along with the South Bay addition, we went up to televise that and camera it the other day, and our DVR camera basically, the DVD TV part of it doesn't record anymore, so we just wanted to record it, bring it back to the shop, turn the lights off in order to even see the screen on it because it's so bright otherwise outside. Well, it doesn't record, so we weren't able to televise that. Brought it around to get it, see about having somebody fix it. It's a DVD VHS recorder, And Molson kind of laughed at me when I brought it in there, it's so old. So we're able to get prices on a new unit, just that part of it. And our camera will hook up to it, so we'll be able, less than half the cost to update it that way. So I've got one more guy supposed to give me a price back, and then I'll get ready to order that out. Water tower inspection, work with Mitch. Got to actually tree setting contract with Owens Inspection Service down in Owens, one that's been doing our water tower inspections since day one out there. He's familiar with it, so he's gonna be the one doing the inspection on it. At that time, we will be draining that tower down. Residents probably won't even notice the difference of pressure. We'll switch over to runoff real water's pressure system for a couple days or more, getting it drained down and getting it filled back up again. So. Park and pool, pool's been shut down. Some it's been winterized. We're still waiting to get together the contractor on the single entry pools with the drainage problems that we had last spring. We wanted to wait until this fall to get that addressed. We wanted to shut the pool down. And we still have got a meeting really set up for that yet, but we're working on that. I think all the parks have been sprayed right now for weeds, and most majority of it's been fertilized. Public buildings, I don't have anything at this time. Then I'll also be gone September 8th through the 18th. So
in regards to you being gone for 10 days,
yep.
Does IE Metro Construction, and someone, you know where I'm going with this, know that Neil's the person to go to when it comes to visual inspections?
Yep.
Okay.
Neil and Jesse are both equally qualified for doing that. So we've all taken the same tests, the same classes. So we're all familiar with any type of inspection.
I'm not worried about you. I'm worried about the guys coming to get you, i.e. the issue we had in Crestman.
And when I change my phone, I'll have it. So I'd contact Neil first and then Jesse after that.
Okay. Last question. Would you spray on the park, the weeds? Would you spray?
I believe LV4 and some type of Terry's one is mixing it up, sprayed it. So
City Park isn't. The big park hasn't been sprayed yet.
Okay.
There's too many flowers around the neighborhood and stuff, so I'm waiting on that. Okay. The sports complex has been sprayed, had real good results up there, and all the golf course got sprayed last week. Turtle Creek's been sprayed, so that's all looking pretty good. I'll hit it again this fall. I just didn't want to do City Park yet.
Okay, that's cool. I don't mean to talk to Tony Randall, man, because I mean, Tony's worked so damn hard on that grass that
he was laughing at me when I sprayed it. I had a good kill. I had a good kill.
Spray him, kill him. All right, thank you.
So, have you had any comments, Craig, from the public on the slurry seal?
I haven't, no. I've had a couple of them really are happy with it and stuff like that. But I also had a couple complaints about somebody getting tore up, which happens. I mean,
I think it looks great.
It does look a lot better. Some of the rock pedals on your boulevard.
It's a number year we'll have to have town done at least once. So.
Sure.
One question. South Main Edition. What's our second one? That's pretty typical. What is there a is that done in a certain number of years after that started, or when a certain percentage of houses or development is done?
It's supposed to be. There's second year is when they're supposed to have it on.
Okay.
And then we'll wait 1 year, then we'll slurry seal it after that.
Okay.
You.
That's all. Awesome.
Yeah. You had mentioned the car counters.
Yep.
They can track like light vehicles versus heavy vehicles.
Yep.
And then they go down to like ATVs and UTVs versus.
It's all by wheel spacing.
It is. So and they'll count like a golf cart then going across. Okay, and it'll tell you.
Really? There's like 9 different classifications of vehicles.
Oh, no kidding. Cool. Well, that would be interesting.
Okay. Any questions for Craig?
Thank you. All right, and we'll go to the finance officer report.
Okay, so in my report, I gave kind of a synopsis of the month end of August with some of the revenue that we had brought in. And then in the box below that has all the totals for the general fund revenues and expenses through the end of July. And then just so to keep you up to date, I have contacted Gov Office when I got back regarding the website, and I've been working with them on a test site that they've given me. It has all the new design on it and everything, and I'm going through a checklist of some things they want me to look at to see if this is how we wanted it set up. And then also we're going to be talking to them and having them help us with reconfiguring the navigation of the homepage. So they'll be working on that with me. We haven't gotten too far with that yet, but hopefully by the next meeting I'll have some more to update on that. And then I also provided the calendar of events that are coming up.
I probably asked this already,
yes,
but I can't remember the answer. Analytics for the website. Do we plan on having analytics, and if so...
You mean as to how many people go to the website?
Well, and also page sensitive, the time they spend there, first viewers, you know, repeat viewers.
We
I mean, it's
have all that now.
We have all that now.
You have all that now. Mm-hmm. I just want to make sure we have that.
It's the same program.
Just sure. Yep, that's not going to change.
Yeah.
No, okay. So we'll have those same data. Yeah.
And that also includes the sublinks also, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
everything
good.
Okay.
It actually gives a percentage and stuff too, also by like a date range that you give it.
You can do
it.
A date range, you can do a time range.
Yeah.
You can do,
and it'll give you like percentages of which pages were hit the most during certain, you know, months or whatever,
so
whatever you want to do.
It'd be nice to see that 6 months from now, you know, when it's...
Sure.
Yeah, okay. All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Has anybody asked for that information ever?
Not for me.
I think at one time you asked for like how many are hitting the website, and I gave you that number. It was quite a bit. It's quite a few.
It is quite a bit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably been a year or so.
What do we do with that information?
What do we do with it?
You could read
it. Somebody asked for it, what would they do with it?
Oh, what would they do with it?
It would just give them the knowledge of what is being hit more often than not, so that we can make sure to, you know, keep that stuff up to date.
And if so, where are they hitting from? I mean, are we getting how much out of state versus in state? How many, you know, and that's why I asked about this page specifics. You know, when it gets to, let's just say, if there would be, there's not though, I assume, is there a housing cell? On the website, the new website?
A housing cell as far as, like, we put, like,
available
rentals
housing.
Are available. Yep.
Yeah.
We have a page.
So if we want to get an idea of what, you know, how many people are looking at rentals in our, how many hits it's getting over a 30-day period, you can kind of get a good idea, you know, what people are looking for and how many and how long they even stay there. They stay there for 10 seconds or 2 minutes and 58 seconds, you know, I mean, it varies. So what you can do then later on down the line is make maybe a page more robust if it's getting a lot of hits compared to, you know, the tax levy page or whatever the case may be. And then that's kind of what's designed for.
And that kind of helped us out with the quick links, because we were able to get some quick links to put on there and stuff. We kind of looked at some of the data on that as well to see where are people going when they go to our website, and kind of tried to hit some of the things that people are interested in and put those in the quick links.
Mm-hmm.
So that was something that helped us with that.
And then we can sell advertising.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not going to.
That's exactly what I was thinking. How do we make money off
that? Yeah, well, Kyle Ed, you go a long ways.
All right. Any other questions, Carter? All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Teresa, with the city administrator report.
Okay, just a few updates. Mitch kind of gave you where we're at with the Mickelson Road project. So we've met with Athens last week. Larry is working with them on a couple items. We've got some information from him today that he's reviewing. Hope to get something by the end of the week going. And he is working with Rob and Ike to final up Stumpy's agreement. Basically, it's just working with the farmer on the crop damage part of it and getting that language in there. So he's working with Rob and Ike to finalize that as well. Also, last week I met with CCOG and Rural Development as far as securing a rural development loan for our second phase for the asphalt, because we will need a loan for that portion of it. Went through to see what information I need to gather. We have started there's a pre-application process to see if we even qualify. So I'm gathering that information for them. I'm going to send that out this week, actually on Thursday, just because it takes a little while to, you know, to go through the whole process, so we wanted to get that started now, so they can start looking at our project and hopefully have funding by the beginning of the year. So we'll start that, and maybe at the next meeting, you know, if we qualify, bring it before you to see if we go ahead with that funding, and I'll have numbers for you. He also gave you an update on the bike trail. Like I said, we have a pre-construction meeting tomorrow. Hopefully we will see something going next week and completed this year. Bids came in good with that project. It was below engineer estimate, about $63,000. So even though we bid it kind of late, we did get a good bid on it. And so we're moving ahead with that. Just wanted to give you an update on the Crestman stop work order. We have a lot of continued work because they have agreed to go ahead and extend the warranty from 2 years to 4 years. I got that in writing from them, and we are going to go ahead and camera it. Per the motion, we'll camera it now in 2 years and in 4 years as well. And of course, our engineers will be doing the testing, you know, the pressure testing and the water test on the pipes to make sure those all are good. One note I want to give you, the After Prom Committee had came a couple months ago, and they were going to do a fun run here in October. Basically, they were going to do it in the morning of October 28th. That's been changed. They found out that's when ACT tests are, so instead of doing the morning, they're just changing it to the afternoon. Same plan, same route or whatnot, just a time change. So just if you're wondering why they're running in the afternoon, that's the reason for it. They just changed the time. One thing I want to ask you about too, now that we have the new laptops, you guys all have Gmail accounts that we need to set up for our box system. Do you guys want to start using that for all city correspondence? You know, right now we're using the emails that you'd give me when you got elected, and we can continue doing that, or we can go to these Gmail accounts. Just the thing is, you're going to have to check them every day, you know, maybe a couple times a day to make sure you're not missing any emails from the city. So I guess I just want to ask you what your preference is. What would, you know, what would you prefer? I guess I just want some guidance. And
I think it'd be a good idea.
I mean, it'd be a nice separation between your, you know, personal emails versus the city emails.
And you could dial in at any point from a remote location and check those.
Just go to your Gmail account. Yeah. 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 Go to Google, bring up Gmail, and log into your account. Okay. And I'll give you. Is that good with everybody?
Maybe not me, I guess. Does it matter if you, if I'm the oddball, that you just keep sending stuff to my account? I mean, I guess, what is it? Do we have to all be on
all
the
nothing,
page,
or
does it matter if you keep sending?
No, it probably doesn't matter to me. It'd be nice if they're all consistent, but
that's fine. If it's got to be, that's cool. Let's do it.
I mean, it doesn't got to be.
Ryan, is this accountability for, think of it like a business. If you have business emails, the business controls the access to them. And so if I'm not sitting in this seat, it's still this person's, this board's email. And then any correspondence that could come in to a council person is then through the city's property, and I'm thinking of the email issue.
I completely understand that. I was more being selfish and thinking of ease of use, I guess. I would agree with you there as well. So.
But you can log on, check out, you know, once in the morning, once at night, you know, you should be covered. And like I said, it's a good separation between, you know, your city business and personal business. And like I said, it's a, you know, current log for, you know, whoever the next one is in line or whatnot, it'll just follow. Okay, so.
Sounds good to me. Makes sense.
I would imagine you could link these on our website too, on the city website for contact.
Yes, exactly. That's just it. Versus having your
city's account.
Right, versus having your personal email out there. I mean, it's the city's account.
My personal email is not out there, is it?
It's whatever you actually gave us, if you gave us permission or not.
Unless not.
You'd have to look on the website. I really don't remember.
I don't remember either. We always ask if it's okay. You said yes, we put out there.
If you say no, then it's just not on there. We have a phone number.
You were around when you were elected, buddy.
You know.
No, I think Mark's got a good, Mark Rankin's got a good point on that. I think it's just good that way. Yeah, we needed to be able to, you know, council person goes off and another one comes in. It's the same email address and all that stuff is right there. I would imagine, I've not had two Gmail accounts before, but I'd imagine you can set your notifications up where you can get all, any of it anywhere you want to have, and so.
Right, yeah, plus that's your account. I will email out then to your other, your personal accounts, the passwords and that, so you can get in there and get it set up, so. Or call you.
You'll share out.
We know, we know.
Yep.
Did you get that figured out after I called?
Yep, I looked in your account and it should all be good. You know, you should be able to log on, so. Okay, we'll start using them then. New flooring at City Hall, it's scheduled to be put in Monday, September 18th. They're gonna come in early in the morning. I'll let them in to do the entryway. It has to set a little bit, you know, for it. So they're gonna come early. By the time 8 o'clock comes around, we'll be able to open the doors and have customers use it, and then we'll start working on the hallways and whatnot. So we won't need to shut down City Hall at all for, you know, that to be put in. Just give you a short update on the right-of-way at Vandermark. I'm still calling every month NAPS and Cogos. They neither one have given me an answer yet on it, so I'll still keep on them. I don't know what the deal is, but.
Would there be any benefit in trying to have a meeting of some sort?
I've actually, Roger, he has been in here twice. Yeah. He's been into my office, and he's on the keys, just still waiting for his son to say what he's going to do. They just haven't given me the
call yet.
I've only met once with Joanne, though, so maybe okay. Do that again.
I believe I heard that Joanne is putting up that property for sale.
Yeah, there's a couple things going on in her property that
is there,
may change things, so, and that I'm aware of, too, so.
Yeah, I just heard,
Job applicants, we were advertising for the part-time code enforcer and for a dump site monitor. I've got a few applicants in for the code enforcer. I'll be trying to interview them this week and next week, so hopefully I'll have a recommendation for our next meeting for you. I didn't have any applicants for the dump site monitor until Thursday afternoon. I had a gentleman come in later afternoon and a decent applicant, so I think we have one viable candidate for that, so. So that's good. Talked to him a little bit about it. He seems interested in it. So I'll talk more with him and maybe hopefully we'll have somebody for that too. And we'll keep it open, see if we get a second one that will maybe help rotate the Saturdays and see what happens. And then I just have a few things down there that will be on probably upcoming agendas that I need to follow up on now that we're, you know, Roger's back and budget's over with, that we'll kind of readdress it. The meeting's coming up. Any questions about anything?
So the job applicant for the dump site monitor, Craig, I should have talked to you, asked you about that. I haven't been by there, is the cable up?
We haven't done anything with the system. Yep, we've just been letting the lights been run until we get to figure out what we're going to do for getting somebody there to monitor it.
You mentioned flooring. Do we ever clean the flooring in here?
We actually have, the carpets are being cleaned next Friday, so.
That's perfect.
Yes, they need it cleaned, don't they? So we thought we'll get those cleaned before and then get the new floor laid and be like brand new.
Sounds good.
Okay. Any questions for Teresa? All right, thank you.
Okay.
I think we're gonna jump on our agenda here. We're going to jump down to our visitor section. So if Brad wants to stay the rest of the time, he can, but he doesn't have to. But we'll jump to Brad Moulton with South Greenwich.
Thank you, Mayor. And I am early. I was on the agenda at the right place. I just came from Mitchell. Their presentation went real smooth, and I just got here early. So, but thank you for moving me up. I appreciate it. So, the reason that I'm here, as it says, I'm Brad Wilson, the administrator for the SDML Workers' Compensation Fund. I've met several of you at the district meeting this last year and at other meetings. But we are celebrating our 30-year anniversary this year. And in As part of that, we're awarding plaques or handing out plaques to our members who have been with us 5, 10, and so on up to 30 years, so that everybody receives a plaque over the next few years. But the SCMO work comp fund, just a little background, and all we do is provide workers' compensation coverage to cities, counties, conservation districts, public agencies in South Dakota. We currently have 447 members. Hartford is one of them and has been for 5 years. The board of trustees is made up of 6 municipal trustees, and the work comp fund is also endorsed by the South Dakota Municipal League, so you are a member of as well. So I won't take any more time, but if you don't mind, I'd like to present the plaque to Mayor Manning. And Teresa, I don't know if you want a photo for the rest of the piece.
Yes.
So if I may,
Yep.
See where he's bred.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, we'll move to old business. We've got Amy, pool manager, here in the season pool report.
All right, we welcome back 4 returning guards this year. It's Riley Danielson, Maddie Monahan, Ashley McDonald, and Gabe Lorraine. Our new lifeguards were Michaela Starrett, Sadie Danielson, and Hannah Drogue. Darcy Brown returned as assistant manager. Also, as assistant manager with the Ann Lifeguards were Riley Danielson and Maddie Monahan. We had a great staff this summer, so hopefully we'll get some coming back next year. This summer, we were off to a great start, and the weather was really warm. We had a lot of busy days. August was unusually cool, so unfortunately the attendance wasn't like we hoped. Despite the low temperatures, our season was still a success. Again, this summer we offered 2 sessions for swim lessons. The first session was in June, and the second in July. Both had good attendance. We sold 245 family passes and 110 individual passes. We reserved 222 pool parties. Parents enjoy having these just for softball, parties, birthday parties, so it's been a good turnout for those. Barb Tyler, who has been great, has also administered another training session, usually at the very beginning of the season. We performed 6 drills throughout the summer. Each of those helped improve our staff's duties and responsibilities. The lifeguards conducted 8 rescues this summer and assisted with 7 first aid procedures. Our season came to a close August 21st. I want to thank all of you for your support, my council members, and for helping with all the issues we have. Our primary goal for the summer is always to make it safe for our patrons. Our lifeguards and assistant managers did a super job. Without their hard work and dedication, this summer would not have been a success. So thank you for all your support and help.
Moving forward, 2018, daycare. Anything in change there? Are we kind of...
Well, I'm hoping. I mean, I'm assuming CARE is going to just continually grow just because as the community grows. Mm-hmm. So I think it's been a good policy. I mean, some might differ that, but we just had to do something because every year it kept growing and growing. And this year it was 90-some. Next year it might be 130-some. And there's got to be a point where we got to say we can only, because it's just not right for other families that also have a path that want to, you know, use it, and then I have to turn them away because, well, we've got too many. And some people, they're like, well, you're not at capacity. Well, you really don't want your pool at capacity because it's not safe. I mean, when it's at capacity, you can't even swim. I mean, they're standing, and because especially you get the shallow end, and it's just, it's crazy. So people will say, well, why? It's not at capacity. You can still, you don't want your pool at capacity because it's just not safe.
And we don't even got the lifeguards to put it at capacity.
Right. Yeah.
Right. The personnel.
Yeah. So I think it's been a good
policy. Well, I hope that you apply next year because of your experience in this issue and that you take a proactive role. Instead of middle of the summer, if at all possible next year.
Well, and I should have done something sooner. I just was hoping it would just, we could work together.
Sure.
Like, because I've done that with all the other daycares, and they've been awesome. And I didn't really want it to come to that, but I'm glad we had to do something because it's just, now it's safe, and it's benefiting everyone. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's benefiting the lifeguards, the workers that bring them. So, that's what we want.
Okay, thank you.
Amy, do you feel like a special pass would be beneficial, a daycare pass or something along those lines?
Well, we do offer treats that we decided to, for any daycares, they can buy a family pass and then they can use their workers to bring them that family pass because we use a family pass where really there's no limit. I mean, as long as they're in their immediate family. So we've offered that to all the daycares. So they can come as they buy a family pass and they can use that for any of their workers. So they give me a list of who the workers are for the season and then they come. So we have a list for them for each daycare provided. And they all utilize that. So it's been good.
So the daycare buys the family pass?
Mm-hmm. Yes. The
she's talking about for the workers.
Oh, yeah.
Not
for the adults.
The
no.
Kids.
Not for the individual kids.
Yeah.
No. I'm sorry. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I think
I'm talking about the workers. So, like, CARE will buy a pass, a family pass for their workers.
CARE is the family. Their workers are the
yes.
recipients of
right.
that.
Right.
Okay.
And same with, like, Stepping Stones or
sure.
Crazy with an Imagination Station.
Sure.
So, is that what you meant?
No, my question was, it's a financial burden to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
When all those kids come and push the pool to capacity, it's a burden for you to staff that. My question, I think I alluded to it at our last discussion regarding this, is if those, would it help us get more staff if we can pay them better? We could pay them better if we collected more income from this. From all of these kids.
Oh, I see.
Do we need to create a separate
category?
Price point.
Well, I know I looked at Colton Pool. They charge more than we do for their family pass.
Mm-hmm.
At least I think it was at least $10 more for family. You know, and I haven't checked Garrison or Brandon, but I can and look into that because I don't even know. I know. Sioux Falls has those patches they offer for all the public pools, but I can look into that and see, because I think it would help to, obviously, I think we get more guards hired
mm-hmm.
by, you know, paying them decent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And even though people say, well, it's not a stressful job, it's you're standing there for an hour at a time.
Those people have probably never lifeguarded them. That's
right.
Good.
So it's not like construction work, but it's definitely mentally exhausting. So that's why we give them the 10-minute breaks per hour. So I think that would be great if they got paid more because they deserve it. And
I think if you would run some numbers on that, I know I would entertain taking a good look at changing our pricing.
I agree. And then it'd be nice because we're always kind of short for guards when it comes to hiring right around pool season. So I think that would definitely help.
It's a supply and demand.
Mm-hmm.
I think the last time, that's about 3 years ago, when we looked at the rates and raised them up.
Right.
And we did compare some, and we were lower, and we raised them up, across the board. But that was about 3 years ago, so we can look at it again.
And as your demand increases your demand.
Right.
You know, you get this supply, which you just said could jump easily by 40.
Oh, easy for one day care. Right.
Yeah, so,
something that we'll anything else?
So, only questions, I just want to say thank you. Good job.
Thank you.
Safe
thank you guys. I appreciate it. All right.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
All right, next item up is to discuss the billboard rental policy. Thank you very much for that.
Yeah, you mentioned a few meetings ago, and just basically had a pretty good discussion about it last time. I just kind of, what fueled this is just focusing more on economic growth for businesses in Hartford. We've got a few things for those east-facing signs out there, you know. One of the things is one business, I think, is using more than one sign. Pizza Ranch out there, not the same on anybody, I shouldn't know that, but anyway,
I can go to Google Earth right now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there you go. But we've taken care of the sublease policy. That's no longer available. So when that's up, it's not going to be an issue. So that's a good thing, I think, in our situation. But I'm just looking at things like we should try and drive growth economically towards Hartford, especially with those east-facing billboards, instead of, you know, letting businesses outside of the city use them. And that's not necessarily to say that that those businesses outside the city can't use them, but let's try and give somebody in town a shot at using them first. So, you know, I mean, obviously this is an open discussion, but the scenario kind of that I've thought of is maybe since Jesse, not to throw you under the bus here as well, but since Jesse has his ear to the ground a lot, he might know of some businesses that are eager to get an ad on one of those billboards. And as a billboard comes up that say the business is not in Hartford, that Hartford business may take precedent over business which is not in Hartford. On top of that, there's one other thing. Yeah, I think that was kind of all I wanted to hit. And I don't know if, you know, that's a policy that we need to go through, if that's too much to ask for Jesse or what, but.
What if, along this line, not to cut you off,
sorry. Yeah, you're good.
What if between Jesse and Teresa, they reviewed, every couple of months, they review what's maturing on leases, what's 3 months out from maturing, for instance, and to give that opportunity to make some calls, see who wants one, and know, hey, we got one that's maturing in a couple of months. If you want a shot at it, better speak up now. We can't do anything with the lease that's in place. Once it's in place, it's there.
Yeah.
But at least it's kind of like a maturing lease report where every couple of months we'll know what's going to be available and ask the chamber and the HA to see if there's anybody interested in. Is that along the lines of what you're thinking?
That's exactly what I'm thinking. I just want to make sure that's enough time for them to get things down and everything like that. I don't know if we need to notify the current
person that's on it as well?
Our Lisa stated that 90 days before renewal that we notify them in writing to see if they want to renew or not.
Okay.
And then we go from there, so.
How many do we have? Six?
Yeah.
Eight. Six.
12 total, they want to go east and west.
Six.
Well, AJDC has one.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
11 is what we have.
So there's six billboards.
East facing ones,
east
yeah.
East facing.
Yep.
And they're 3-year leases.
Yes.
So, not to step on your toes, but I think every 2 or 3 months is a little too often.
Too often.
Yeah.
That's going to come.
So we usually have a couple come due a year, just depending on when they've taken out the lease. Yeah.
I mean, you can just put a notification on the calendar.
But I know, but yeah, let's do now. I'm marking when the 90 days is coming up so I can contact who's currently got the lease, but at that same time, you know, talk with Jesse, and once they let me know whether they want to renew or not, if they don't, then we can see if there's anybody else interested, you know.
Or maybe at that point, Jesse, at 6 months, Jesse's going to be spreading the word.
I'm trying to think. The only east-facing one that's not a local business is the Humboldt Bar. And if I'm not mistaken, we just renewed that more than 4 years.
Then the antique mall.
There's the antique mall across. Interstate.
And then there's 2 pizza ranch signs. I guess if it was up to me, I'd prefer that there just be 1 business per the billboard. Just because
the pizza ranch
to share the wealth, I guess, you know.
The pizza ranch sign that's being subleased by ABR. They're gonna give that up because ABR called me and said that they're looking for a new rental, and actually I referred them to a business in town that is looking at giving that, so hopefully they'll start subleasing.
So.
Yeah, that'd be all we have.
So.
I think it sounds like with internal staff, you can come up with some strategies to work with that.
You guys comfortable with that? Yes.
Sounds good. Yeah. And Teresa's direction on that, we need to work with her on, and as things come up and as she sees fit.
I mean, it's not a huge thing, like we said. There's not a lot of these coming up, but you know, after say we're all gone, the Humboldt Bar comes up, then you can look at it. Then you know, it sets precedence for down the road.
Right.
I thought you were going to tell me you found a way to put another 6 or 8 up and get even more revenue for the city.
Right. Love to, man. Love to. Let's annex over by the first exit. Let's start doing it.
But even with the whole bar, if they want to renew, if they've been in compliance and paid their way, they have it first, right?
No, it just says 90 days before the renewal, we contact them, and if both parties agree to the renewal, they can renew.
So we can
it's not them. A guarantee.
Right,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
We can set that
yeah.
Up.
Yeah.
Since the agenda item reads discuss policy on billboard rental, just real briefly, I just want to get, if you want to go down the pipe,
well,
Jonesy.
Nothing.
Westbound. Jesse and I have talked about this. I have talked to Jesse about it. But in regards to having an incentive for a business that wants to relocate or start a business in Hartford to offer a westbound, okay, correction, eastbound sign, west-facing sign to a business for 1 year at no charge. I just want to get your thoughts. Straight up, heck no, but I think it might separate us from the crowd a little bit, and, you know, I would like to actually briefly, in 2 minutes or less, discuss. Ryan, go.
What do we have as far as the...
Yeah, 2 naked signs that have not been covered for quite some time now, and we usually have at least 2, if not sometimes 3,
that don't have anything on them.
I'd have no problem with that.
Travis?
You know, I'm gonna be honest here.
That's why I'm asking.
I was thinking more about your comment on the policy. We hadn't really discussed how we were gonna change the policy. So I, you'd have to repeat your question.
Okay, that's fine. Using the eastbound signs, Mark's laughing over here again. The eastbound sign, west facing, okay? Notoriously, I can never remember having all the signs filled. I never have them. To give Jesse the opportunity to offer one of those signs, a new business, be it recruitment for employing 100 people at this manufacturing plant, or, you know, just bringing in those 10 employees for whatever said business might be. And we can set criteria, have to have a minimum of 10 employees or whatever. To offer that billboard to that business, I think that's economic development. And then maybe separate us from our competition as far as, you know, saying, okay, you sign up with us, you hop on board with us, we're going to invest in you a little bit and offer this sign for you for a year. Kind of kick it around, I want to get your thoughts.
I think that's a great idea.
Okay, Mark.
How much is the lease?
$300-some, a little less, isn't it?
No. If it's going that way, it's $325.
Yeah.
It's more. We give a break for the other facing ones that are coming into Hartford because we figure they're Hartford businesses. So that's only that's a little less. That's only two.
Okay, so $325.
Yeah.
Yes, I would support that. But HABC also has funds at their discretion to spend. And if they felt that was a deal breaker, then they would have that opportunity to do it if they wanted without coming to us. Or they could come to us for reimbursement after the fact.
There we go.
Just saying, there's other avenues for it.
Absolutely, absolutely. Good point.
But I would.
Harder?
Either way, I'd be fine either way.
Mark Monahan.
You spoke my opinion.
The 30-second version, please. Oh man, here we go.
Free west-facing billboard to a business coming to this town is such incredibly small potatoes that it's going to be irrelevant.
Fair enough.
Here's the other thing that I think, too, not to interrupt if you were going to keep going. They're going to also have to pay for vinyl, which is half of that there. So, you know, Mark mentioned the HADC funds. You know, if we give it to them for free, HADC may be able to get in and say, here's a vinyl, but I kind of agree with you a little bit.
In my mind, the west-facing billboards that catch the eastward-bound traffic, I would much rather see somebody put in an effort to try to rent those to somebody on the Cliff Avenue Interstate corridor, the Brandon corridor, you know, tailgaters, Love's Truck Stop, Brian Tan. I mean, to me, that makes more sense.
And the one thing that could really kind of make me want to bring this up is because we all know that there's people that drive by that sign every day, and they go to work in Sioux Falls. If we get a business, and I'm thinking more recruitment than anything, really, I am, that if there's a business in Hartford, wanting to move to Hartford, signing on in Hartford, and these people are, you know, in a snowstorm, driving by the sign every single day, going, "Gotta get sick of this." That's kind of the call, the action, you know, and that's what I'm thinking, you know. And so, I want to drop it at this point. I just wanted to have this discussion for the sake that, you know, that remote possibility does happen, that we can say we actually discussed it and we kind of have an idea where we're at. Thank you, Devin.
Since you said, "God, I'm sick of this," it made me think of the billboard that says "Star Star," whatever. God, I'm sick of seeing that because it doesn't do anything.
Well, it's gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's the point? We could rent that to anybody. Okay. We should rent it to somebody on Cliff or
Brandon. Oh yeah.
We should rent it to them at double the rate.
It's not for a lack of trying. Teresa has tried.
And we should say if somebody local comes and has interest in that, then boom, you're gone. That's my. If we're gonna have opinions. That's my opinion.
Fair enough. Do us some from over here.
Well, I think it's enough to get your wheels turning, and I think you got enough flavor of what the council would have an appetite for, if that is something the HADC or a chamber, you know, wanted to put some more meat around, or maybe come up with a proposal of some sort. I wouldn't be surprised if this council, they would be very open to hearing that, I would say.
Yeah, Scott Dorsey came up with the idea. I think it would be a nice strong gesture, especially say if Company X is relocating to Hartford and is hiring 60 new people. Things like that do make a big difference, and to have a community going to put itself at that cost and that visibility on there, I think says a lot of commitment to the community. Mm-hmm. I think the value is way intangible. I think it's more of a goodwill type of effort versus an actual monetary thing. Either way, I think it's a good idea.
I think everybody would be in favor of goodwill, but and not Scott's idea, but in the grand scheme of things, what do we have on Main Street? Two lots? Three lots? On the corner of
the city
first,
owns?
Yeah.
We have three small lots. Yeah.
Three small lots. So that's, what is that, 77 feet?
66. 66. 22 each.
Okay, so I would much rather, if we're going to have a conversation, I would much rather have a conversation about giving those three lots away to somebody that's going to build a building
and
come to Main Street.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. I would entertain the idea of giving the land away instead of having a conversation about a free billboard.
Free land, there you go.
That's what I'm saying. Billboards are all nice and fuzzy, but you know, that's in my mind, that's not even a potato, it's so small.
Yeah.
I want to talk about a bigger potato, not a tater tot.
So. Jeff said that you're jumping to the bed, right?
Hey man, I came on the good day talking about
yeah,
my
yeah, you came on the good day. Get this on. Are you next on the agenda?
Alright. Jesse and I actually had this conversation.
I think we're off the billboard subject.
Okay,
there. So what we're going to do is we're going to move on. But I appreciate those comments. I think that's good. Gives some good direction on the
okay.
New business. We have the land purchase proposal from Jeff Turner. And Chase, I believe you can give us some background on this.
Yeah, so the city got the drainage way from Gerald and Lori Pressman in Crestwood Development. Jeff Turn has the property. It's right at the corner of Crestman Trail and Mickelson Road. It's at the southeast corner, it would be. He was wondering if the city would entertain selling a portion of that to him. We've basically brought in some dirt, filled it in a little bit, poured the sidewalk, placed that there. His lot is 120 feet deep, and then there's 55.6 feet going north of his lot that could be sold that before you get the street right away. We don't want to sell any of the street right away, of course, in case we ever expand or whatnot. He put in an offer, which is in your packet, to purchase that property. I do want to give you one more bit of information that I learned today. I guess Mitch had called Craig on Friday, and I was off on Friday. Mitch looked at that area, and that drainage way through there, that spot right north of his property is meant to be a detention area, actually. Right. So we shouldn't have filled it in. We should probably dig it out, and we probably should keep control of it. So
yeah, that would be my recommendation. I look back at the drainage plans from that development, and that area is meant for the water to back up to store the water on the big events so it doesn't come over the Mickelson Road. So with what's been filled in, I figure we probably lost about 10% of that volume. And that just means that without that volume, that road will tend to, on those big events, the water will tend to overtop that road more often. You know, which would put it out of compliance with your design standards.
You're talking about water coming off of South Main?
Off of Crestman.
Off of Crestman.
Yeah. Yeah.
So is there a culvert running under Crestman Trail there?
No, there's not.
There's not.
No. You gotta remember there's a culvert that runs under Mickelson Road.
Yep.
And you know that culvert is only handles the roll, the minor events we call them.
Okay.
So on a big event, that culvert's backed up. Water's not getting through it, and the water basically ponds in that area until the rain ceases and it can get through that culvert. So in that time, it needs a certain volume to back up and store there, and that area there accommodates that.
Okay. So how often would that be wet then?
Well, it drains dry. So once the rain's done, the culvert handles and everything drains dry after that.
So there normally wouldn't be water sitting in there. It's just on.
There hasn't been since we went there.
Yeah. No. It'd probably get some cattails growing there.
Yeah, that's about it. Yeah, and it was more towards behind our house than on the side of it.
Is this the land we took control of from Crestman?
Yes.
And that corner by his house, right?
Correct.
That was all included in that.
Since we're talking drainage, on the west side of Crestman, same deal. Ponds up.
Yeah.
Flows north.
There's a culvert in there, though, isn't there?
On the west side of Crestman's place?
Yeah, the west side of Crestman Trail.
Oh, west side of Crestman Trail.
West side of Crestman, because you're saying there's nothing under Crestman Trail from east to west.
Yeah.
So on the west side of Crestman Trail, where we've had drainage issues in the past, or thought we did, whatever the case was, there's a culvert that runs under.
Yep, ties into the storm sewer on Mickelson Road.
And the one on the east side of Crestman Trail ties into the storm sewer.
Yeah, ties into the storm sewer as well. And then that storm sewer goes along Main Street all the way to the creek.
So, big rain event, storm sewer flowing full.
Yeah.
Those detention ponds fill up, even bigger event, it overtops Mickelson, flows north towards Turtle Creek.
Yeah, it would flow down Main Street.
Flow down Main Street.
Yeah,
okay.
So, if you walk me through that a little bit, if we did nothing and we left it, or we left it the way it was and turned property over to Jeff, let's say, and there's a huge rain event and there's a lot of flooding and we're outside of our own design standards. We're the one who violated our own design standard on that. What liability does the city have on that?
You want to take that, Larry?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Well, I think you've stepped into the legal food chain. The argument is you violated your standards, but for it, you kept the 10% excess flow, it wouldn't have to flood. And if you're with your design standards, everybody knew in advance that you built it for the 100-year flood, and it'll overtop after that. I think you have to have it comply with your design standards, and if you're going to sell that piece of property, then I think you'd have to have the seller agree that he would create and maintain a drainage easement in size and form and manner that complies with the drainage standards. And that guy's got to be asking, well, why do I want this if I can't make it into a big yard or whatever your plan is? Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm going to support a settlement if you bring it to in compliance with our design standards.
So basically, I'd have to make it a ditch. My concern is this, honestly, with it. I mean, I don't mind doing whatever you guys want. It was aesthetically pleasing before. We spent money on sod to sod your guys' land so that it looked nice going down there. And it actually looked pretty cool. Like, it looked nice with the thing. Like, I didn't mind it at all. And then when they filled it in, we were on vacation, and apparently across the street they said they maintained the thing so it wasn't going to get filled there or whatever, you know. That's what I was told. And so I have no problem either way, but I bet there's been, by the time it gets all dug back out, all that dirt and everything that grows back, not to mention how it's kind of been poured up. I mean, it just looks like crap, to be honest with you, compared to what it did. And I know you can't go retroactive back and do something. It's just frustrating because, you know, I was going to sod it out, put sprinklers in, and do it that way. I don't want you guys to have floods, man, so I'm not trying to cause a problem. But at the end of the day, I just would like it to, when you guys do it back, if you guys do it that way, you know, make it not a muddy mess. That's kind of my only concern with it, because we've done a good job of making it look good. Like I said, we spent a few extra $100 to sod it out.
Still could be used for retainage and have grass in it.
I didn't know the goal is to try to keep it maintained.
Yeah, that's what the original intention was. The is to get the slopes so we can mow it once we took it over, because it was a mess, and and it got a little carried away and we're filling it in, so.
Oh yeah, we don't want.
I talked to Mitch about it, and we figured out that it's supposed to be there for detention part, so.
And you don't want it to look like woods, you know, along Crescent in your backyard, because that's full of cattails and brush back there.
We wanted to keep it so we could mow it, because we'd be the ones maintaining it and mowing it, so we, that's where, that's what we'll do, is we'll end up taking, digging it back up and make it sloped, so we still hold the retention to it, detention area, but what else, so we can keep it mowed.
If you guys did that, and, you know, it turns out it looks nice, I mean, I'd still purchase to have a bigger lot, man, just to have it, man, I'd still give you guys some money for it and maintain it, as far as the grass and stuff. I don't know how that works. I don't know the rest of the maintaining the ditch area, but so my lot was bigger. I mean, I got a 2-year-old that, as long as there's not cattails in there, we can run wild, because there's never water in there, really. So, I mean, that's an entertainment down the road. I'd still do that to make my lot bigger up until the thing, but I don't know anything about the drainage stuff, so I don't want to step over my bounds there. Yeah, they put that in now. Yeah, man. I just don't want it to, with our sod and everything, I just don't want it to look bad when you guys dig a deck out, because that's the phrase. Feels like money mess, you know, right now while we're waiting. And they've been great, so they've been great helping us. I mean, at least they're filling it in and doing everything. Everybody from the city's been great, so.
Does that agreement to maintain it as a retention area transfer with ownership? So Jeff and his wife decide to sell it someday. Does that get added to the deed? How does that work?
There needs to be an easement on there if you're going to turn that one over, like Larry was suggesting.
Okay.
One thing about our drainage easements is we don't allow fences in there, so if you're
we don't plan it out there or anything. No. Because what we were going to do if we sodded it, we were just going to put little pine trees all the way on the outside of the land to make it visible. I mean, our fence where it's at is the only fence we're going to have on that.
That'd be probably my biggest concern is if you ended up with the fence in there. But your drainage easements don't allow fences in there, so that's something you'd have to understand.
Sure.
But you'd surely want a drainage easement through there.
Sure.
And Craig, I'm trying to think back. I mean, I've driven by there hundreds of times. Of course, I've paid attention to that specific little niche. But, I mean, let's just go spring thaw. Okay? That's so. Have you ever, how deep was that ditch in there before it got filled?
It was, well, the same depth as the one on the west side.
The opposite side?
At one time, you were talking about putting a culvert.
Really? It was.
There wasn't ever a culvert installed.
Okay. So do you ever recall, you know, water backing up that far to the point where there's 2 feet of water there?
I've never had, but we've never had big rain events.
You got to remember its size for when the development's fully built out. You know, it goes all the way up to the interstate, so more rooftops. It's designed to handle water from more rooftops and more zone.
For more development to itself.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily designed for it today, but it's designed for it tomorrow.
Right.
Down the road.
Wow,
kind of
makes sense. Tough decision here.
Okay.
Not really. I think my feeling is, I don't know if we need a motion for this or not, but I think I'd like to see a proposal from the city administrator, basically a purchase agreement to meet the requirements that Mitch needs and that Larry needs and that what you need. Bring it to us and then we can talk about it.
Would that be like you guys essentially do what you're supposed to make it back what it was and then we can figure something out after that?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm cool with that. Like I said, I just know, like, when we originally moved in, when it was the Crescents, we paid our mow guy to mow it every once in a while. This year, I know it was going to turn over, so we didn't. But as long as it's nice and looks good, I would be entertaining to purchase it so that my whole lot is that, and then we would just mow it ourselves up until the sidewalk's up.
All right. And so what I'm looking for, I think, is for you to talk with the lawyer, administrator, and the engineer to get it the way it needs to be and make sure that down the road we don't violate any green. Because we can sit here and debate this all night, but they're a lot smarter than I am on this stuff.
Way smarter than me too,
Larry.
As you can tell, I'm not a little person in this stuff. I just left free land earlier, so.
Were you making that an official motion?
Do I need a motion for that?
I think we could use a motion for some of this here.
All right.
Okay.
Anyone to say? Larry? Any of them?
Well, let's have the city administrator prepare an offer and agreement to purchase that would contain terms and conditions that would be part of a permanent easement that would run with the property and would be binding on the land purchaser.
And that would alleviate, like, you know, if something happened flood-wise because of the way it was constructed, we wouldn't be liable.
What I'm gonna have in there, I'm just thinking out loud.
Sure.
Don't be surprised if I have some other things.
Okay.
What I'm gonna have in there, if you own it, the right for the city to flood it. Okay, that piece of property, because that's what its purpose is for.
Right.
Is to flood it. I'm gonna have in there obligations that you can't alter any of the embankment, that you have to keep it mowed and debris free, you can't plant trees, et cetera, and that you would on demand of the city clean it out in the event that it needed to be cleaned out to maintain those old contours.
Okay, cool.
Okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, I didn't quite catch all of that, and I also wanted to make sure that I could actually take it as a motion that Brenneman said, though, what you said, so could we repeat what the motion should say?
I'll make a motion.
Okay.
For the city attorney to draft a purchase agreement for the land with, I'm sorry, hear your name.
Jeff.
Jeff.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Can you vote on that? And I have just a couple of comments.
All right, we got a motion and a second.
Hey, my concern is that since the time we took it over from Creston, we've invested money in it. And now we're gonna invest more money in it. We're gonna invest Teresa's time, we're gonna invest Larry's time, we're gonna invest Mitch's time and Craig's time, and we're gonna sell it. I assume nobody's made mention of the offer, but at the current offer, we are going to lose money and lose control of a drainage retention pond that was designed to serve a purpose. So in my mind, at least at the current offer, it makes absolutely no sense to lose money and lose control of that piece of property.
I'll expand on that a little bit. I think over time, we will not lose money. I mean, as far as that's going to be his land, he doesn't have to pay taxes. Okay. If I figured it correctly, and anybody help me out here, because I'm not an expert on this either, but at the offer he's making, is it $2.22 per square foot? Does that sound about right? I mean, Mitch? I mean, we've got 120 in width, 55.6 in length, divided by $3,000, and multiply that is 6,672 square feet. Am I right so far? Divide that by 3,000 equals $2.22 per square foot.
Okay.
I mean, I could be wrong, but I just want to.
That's what I came up with.
You did? Okay. Which I feel, you know, I mean, just from a commercial standpoint, you know, Jesse talks about this all the time. You know, that's a fairly competitive and fair offer, in my opinion. But I do understand, Mark, what you're saying about the initial factor. But I disagree with you in regards to losing money.
You think $2.20 is comparable to what his assessment is on his current lot?
I'm not sure, but I think in the long term, it would absorb the amount of money that we put into it and time. And I mean, how many man hours did it take to fill that up?
I wasn't there, so I couldn't tell you for sure.
Okay.
I'd be there a couple days.
That's on the city.
Terry, what you got?
Either way, it's got to be tore up.
I'm just saying. I don't, you know, we always talk about gaining control. We wanted control on both sides of the creek so we can control. We want control of this, we want control of that. And it's all for water and flood. Every discussion we have is about controlling water and gaining control of property that we need to have control of. a retention pond for a 100-year storm event that's going to eventually drain everything south of his property. In my mind, that's something that I want to have control over. Nothing against him. I want to have control over.
Great point. Front page of the Argus Leader. City of Sioux Falls is buying up land, everything except one house owned by some mortgage company in New Jersey, so that they stop flooding people's houses. And I totally agree about the control portion of this. And that, my comment was kind of tongue in cheek, because we've already invested a ton of money into it.
Yeah.
And sure, you can have it if you dig it all out.
Right. Well, see, my thing is this, if you guys are going to get back. Like I said, I, if it looks nice, you guys can control all you want. My point was, if you guys are going to have to dig it out anyways, give you guys $3,000, $2,000, whatever it is back, that you would, that's, I'm saying you're not, it's not really losing you. You guys are essentially getting more money than you get, because you're going to have to fix it anyway. So you're going to have to spend that money.
I worry about having this discussion next month, or next meeting, when the guy on the west side of the street wants to buy that portion, and the guy to the south of you wants to buy some of his. And the next moat being built, detention pond east of Crestman's, when those people come to us and want to start buying those retention ponds up, I think we set a bad precedent.
Who cleans it out when it gets silted in?
City does.
The city cleans out silted in property if it's private property?
No, not private property, no.
So we just so in the event this happens, we put that on him.
Or the next,
that's not a shovel, that's a backhoe.
What are you referencing? I'm sorry, I don't know anything about that.
Well, if it's made for detention and you get enough silt and sediment in there, and that area gets built up, someday that's not going to qualify as a retention pond for a 100-year storm event.
Oh, I see what you're saying, though.
And then if there's a permanent easement through there, then that's you or whoever owns that property gets to dredge that out. So.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not trying. I want the land flat with sod and sprinklers. I just offer because I would enjoy the extra land to have. If it's a problem, I'm not trying to cause a problem with the land itself. I just think that the financial part of it makes sense. I mean, the financial part makes sense. I'm going to pay property tax on it. You can get $3,000 back if you invest more money into it. The rest of the stuff will turn. That's a different kind of conversation.
So,
like
again, what if the consultant just up to where it starts to go down or within a few feet? Because it's not all sloped, it's flat, and then there's a pond. Still think it sets precedent that we don't want.
How do we usually handle those, that Craig, or those types of area when we plant grass after everything?
If we can blow them, we'll maybe take them, but if they're wet, we can allow them to grow up into cattails as long as they're going through the hole, they're not washing out.
And then around the cattail things. I mean,
just try to keep as clean as you can. And we might have to eventually implement a program to order, have somebody go in there and actually retake some of these back out there and get something in.
Craig brought it to my attention this morning, stuff that Mitch was asking us to remove part of that dirt out of there again. Part of the reason we filled it in is so we can maintain it. It was where you couldn't mold it. So we filled it in here 3 weeks ago, a month ago, filled it in, and Jeff came up with a proposal to purchase the ground. Now Mitch is asking us to remove it so it's old for retention pond. Until we get that dug back out and can maintain it the way we want to maintain it, the city.
I think we have to put it back to the way it's designed, not what's easiest for us to maintain.
The design was there, but you couldn't mold.
There's enough flat area up there where we can cut some of that down to make the capacity still there, but still the elevation.
Well, maybe it's a sore subject for me because I live on Part T. Everybody filled in the ditch up there.
That's all I ever hear about. So I'm in support of taking every last cubic yard of dirt out of there, putting it right back to the way it was.
Yeah, I mean, we gotta when we do it, we're going to make it so we can go in there with the
what is that the right thing to do? That's my question. Yeah.
Putting it back to where
it's easy.
Versus putting it back to the way it's designed.
It means, we'll put it back in so we got capacity. We've got enough shoulder work that we can bring some of that in and still maintain the capacity.
The way it's designed should be
maintainable.
There you go. That's, so let's put it back to the way it's designed.
Yeah.
if it wasn't maintainable, then maybe it wasn't to the design, or right. Need to reevaluate the design.
You go over to the west side, and Mr. Holloway, he's mowing everything that he can. But if the slope was at a more gradual slope, he could mow clear to the bottom. But maintain the whole thing. And that's the way this side was. You couldn't go to the bottom.
This was worse.
And Cressman's behind Cressman's house. I've went in there and mowed that after you guys retained it. And I had to hook the gator onto it so I could mow it.
Well,
I mean, the slope is.
I know Mr. Monahan doesn't like them, but they got these goats you can hire.
I've seen it. All right, before we get too far off, I think what we'll do, we got a motion and a second. Anybody need to hear it again?
I'd like to hear it again.
Okay. Brandon moves to have the city attorney draft a purchase agreement for the land with Jeff Thurn. Nelson second.
Okay. Any more discussion? All right. We'll call the vote. Nelson?
Yes.
Horn?
No.
Keel?
No.
Brandon?
Yep.
Jones?
No.
No.
SOL, huh?
So can I get confirmation though that it gets put, if it's taken care of again, and it'll look like it used to, where my house isn't being a money mess next door?
Hopefully it'll look better.
It should look better.
And I hope you save me some time and effort too, because that sounds, the way you described it, I don't want anything to do with that. So.
All I can say is we're going to bring it back to what the design is going to be, and whatever that design is, should be maintainable. Like Mitch said, that's about all I can get. That's
fine. You can make an intention pond that you can mow because there's one in my neighborhood.
Yeah, right.
I mean, there's no reason why we cannot make an intention pond that is easily accessible by mower.
Yep.
Right. I say we're still going to seed all the dirt area.
Nice to check with Mitch before we, like I said, we were just going to go in there just to get it so you can mow it because you couldn't before. But we'll go in there, we'll reshape it, we'll make sure we make plenty of capacity for it. So we can mow it, we'll seed it back down. It's not heavy, there's not a lot of water that runs into there, so it's not gonna wash out, you know, unless we'd end up the 100-year storm event.
Yeah. Sorry, you're not gonna hydro seed it or anything like that? Or, no? Okay.
Just like we do with the rest of them, throw growing grass in there and let it take over.
Can we make sure that doesn't like get all, be careful with it? I mean, you know what I mean? I got sod, that's my only concern. I spent a lot, man. That's just what I'm saying. I just spent so much water money with you guys, man.
All right,
thanks, man. That's all I have. All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, guys.
Have a good
night. Mayor. Yes.
Just a little water 101. What the state law says is that when it rains, the dominant guy, the guy on top of the hill, has the right to discharge all the water that rains on the guy down below. I guess state law. And if you alter the rate of flow, in other words, the surface, the law says that you can increase the volume of water that goes off your property.